Every week on Science Fantastic, we profile some of the most amazing developments that are changing the way we view the world and the universe itself. Well, with us today is an evolutionary biologist talking to us about the future of humanity. What will humans look like in the future? The book is called Future Humans, Inside the Science of Our Continuing Evolution. And we're very glad to have with us today Professor Scott Solomon. He's an evolutionary biologist at Rice University and a professor in the Department of Biosciences. And also, once again, you're listening to Science Fantastic. If you want to find out more about my work, go to my website, mkaku.org, mkaku.org. We have 3 million fans on Facebook. Every week we have about 1 million fans on Twitter. And you can see the books that I've written. I've written 4 New York Times bestsellers. The latest one is called The Future of Humanity. Humanity in the Space Program as we begin to go back to the moon, to Mars, and even beyond, maybe even to the universe itself. And so once again, go to my website, mkaku.org, mkaku.org. Well, once again, with us today is Professor Scott Solomon. He's an evolutionary biologist and professor at Rice University in the Department of Biosciences. And he's written a great book. I highly recommend it. It's called Future Humans, Inside the Science of Our Continuing Evolution. So does evolution have a direction? Where is Homo sapiens going into the future? So, Scott, glad you could be on Science Fantastic.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
First question for you is, how did you, as a youth, as a young boy, first get interested in science and then biology?
Yeah, so I grew up as a kid, like many kids, that spent a lot of time outdoors. And for me, I think science and nature were really kind of intertwined as a child. I spent a lot of time digging for dinosaur bones in my backyard, and although I never found any, I always imagined that I might, and I think it helped my imagination to think about maybe going off, to places beyond my backyard and to make discoveries and to explore.
So that okay, yeah, and then what got you interested in evolutionary biology?
Right. So I actually started college imagining that I would become a doctor. I was a pre-med student at University of Illinois. And, part of that was because I, at the time, didn't understand how many options there are for careers in science, in particular in biology, other than in medicine. And so I sort of thought, if you like biology and you want to have a career, that you become a doctor. And so it was during my time in college that I started getting involved in research in some of the labs of professors at my university, that I discovered that there are other ways that that people study science and study biology and apply their knowledge to make discoveries. And that was fascinating to me. But really, the thing that clinched it for me was I had an amazing opportunity. One of my professors invited me to be his research assistant in the Galapagos Islands. The professor's name was Martin Wachelski, and he was working on marine iguanas in the Galapagos Islands. And he gave me just the chance of a lifetime to go down there with him, and we spent a few days camping on an uninhabited island in Galapagos and studying these marine iguanas. And I was hooked. I just thought, wow, how do I get to do something like this in my life? And that's what made me decide to apply for the PhD programs in evolutionary biology.
Okay, now, when I was a kid, I used to read a lot of science fiction. And in science fiction, universally, they paint a picture of where humans are going in the next 1,000, 10,000 years. Universally, we're going to have gigantic heads. We've been getting bigger and bigger and smarter, so we're going to have gigantic heads. We'll be bald. We'll lose our hair. We've been losing hair for hundreds of thousands of years. And we'll have very small bodies because we don't really need to be strong anymore. So we'll be gigantic brains. Now, doesn't that violate what we know about evolution? So tell us a little bit about whether or not our brains are getting bigger or, in fact, maybe getting smaller since the time of the Neanderthals.
Yeah, that's right. So you're touching on some of the trends in our evolutionary past in which our heads initially expanded dramatically. Of course, what made us distinct from our primate cousins, but then there more recently had been a trend towards to somewhat smaller heads, certainly compared with some of the other species of humans that we once shared the earth with. But if we look at what's happening today, the evolutionary forces that are at work on humans today, which is the subject that I cover in my book, Future Humans, what we see is that natural selection and other evolutionary forces are still at play, but they're operating in ways that are quite different from how they've operated in the past. So to touch on some of the specific aspects of the human body that you were asking about, the head is something that we do know quite a bit about. And actually, the size of the head has been constrained throughout our evolutionary history by having to fit through the birth canal. So the human head expanded dramatically throughout the course of our evolutionary past. But it could only become so large because babies still have to pass through the birth canal. So that has imposed an upper limit, a maximum size on how big our heads could become. But there is something interesting about what's happening today related to head size, and that is that as cesarean sections become a more and more common way for births to happen, and in fact, in the U.S., they make up about 30% of all births. In Brazil, they make up 50% or more of all births. And so as these cesarean sections become more common, it is sort of freeing up that constraint. The head doesn't have to fit through the birth canal, and so it is sort of freed up to become larger. Now, if we get to a point in which C-sections become the only way that births happen, and there's a number of reasons why that could happen, that would then free up our head to continue to expand to, you know, perhaps look something like the depictions from science fiction. So it's not entirely outside of the realm of possibility that our heads could become much larger in the future if C-sections become a much more common form of birth, or even if they become the only way that births happen.
Now, when a baby horse is born, within a few hours, they're able to run with the adults. In fact, it's a matter of survival if they cannot run with the adults. But a baby, I read once that a baby in some sense is like a fetus, because it takes 18 years for the brain to expand in size to accommodate all the complexities of adult life and society. So it takes 18 years before we're mature and can run with the adults. And that's how big our brain is, that our brain is so big it cannot fit through the birth canal. But basically, we're a fetus for 18 years. This hour, we're going to talk about the future of the human race, not the future of the universe, as we usually talk about, but the future of humanity itself. Where are we going? The book is called Future Humans, Inside the Science of Our Continuing Evolution. The author is Professor Scott Solomon. He's a professor at Rice University in the Department of Biosciences. So we're talking about, well, what are humans going to look like in the future? Now, Charles Darwin once said that, well, a lot of evolution is directed by the female. The female chooses which male to mate. And then the question boils down to is, well, what do females want? What do women want? Do women want men with gigantic heads? I mean, do they want nerdy men that are super smart? Why did we become intelligent if women selected smart men, differentiating ourselves from the Neanderthals and early man? Some people say that it's not nerdy smart that women select for. It's the smart that allows you to survive, the smart that allows you to outwit enemies and provide shelter. In other words, success. Whether success is financial success or success in the jungle, that's what women want. And then the question is, a byproduct of that is a big brain. So does that theory hold up, that women basically choose which way evolution's going to go? So women choose not the so-called nerdy men, but men who are successful, whatever success means, success in the forest or success on Wall Street.
Yeah, this is a great question. So you're right that the idea that there's something other than just survival that matters to our evolution was one of Darwin's other major contributions, in addition to natural selection, the idea of sexual selection, as he called it. And so one of the things that really interested me when I was doing the research for my book, Future Humans, was to discover that we actually know much less about how mate choice decisions happen, about how sexual selection operates in humans, than we know from other species. We know actually a lot more about this process in birds and insects and many other species than we know about humans. And in part, that's because we can't perform the same types of experiments on humans that we sometimes perform on other species. But some of the things that we have learned are that there are, in fact, cues that have evolved in our past to give us information in making mate choice decisions. As you said, in most species, this is typically the female who is selecting her mate and choosing certain qualities, certain attributes of the male when making those mate choice decisions. So intelligence does seem to be an important factor, not surprising. But there are other factors as well that seem to be really important in human mate choice decisions. And they have to do with actually some of physical characteristics like symmetry. How symmetrical a person's face is has a big influence on how attractive people generally find that person to be. But there are other cues as well, including body odor. So it turns out that women are incredibly good at using smell, using odor cues, to actually get information about men. And so, for example, women are able to use scent and smell of a man to determine things like how closely related that man is to her. So this is thought to have evolved to prevent women from having romantic relationships with close relatives. But today, we're starting to modify those cues, right? We cover up our odors. We use perfumes and deodorants and other types of things in ways that might actually be affecting those mate choice decisions that evolved in our ancestors. So there are quite a lot of these types of cues, and we're learning more about them. But what we're seeing is that the way in which that process is playing out today seems to be quite different from how it's played out in the past.
Okay, now also in your book, you talk about computer dating. I mean, years ago, thousands of years ago, we lived in small tribes, maybe about 100 people, let's say. And so your mate choice was very limited as a consequence. You were basically a nomad going from one hunting ground to the next hunting ground. But now we have, of course, the internet and we have computer dating. So how is that going to change human evolution?
Yeah, that's a great question, and it's something that that I actually write about in the book, because as I was just describing, we use these cues in choosing our romantic partners that we're often we're not necessarily aware that those are the factors that are affecting how attractive we find a person to be. But the use of online dating or dating apps, the use of the internet in finding our romantic partners may actually be playing a really large role in our evolution today, because it can really bias who ends up meeting up with whom. So if you think about a dating app or an online dating website as being sort of an initial filtering step that might determine who ends up going out on a first date, well, in that case, there are certain types of information that are available about another person, especially some visual information, a photograph, right, a picture. But things like odor, aren't certainly not available, right? So until somebody develops a scratch-and-sniff dating app, we don't have the ability to use odor cues in the same way that we would use, as you were just describing, in an in-person encounter. If you meet somebody one-on-one, whether you realize it or not, the smell of that person might actually be influencing how you feel about that person and could make you romantically attracted to that person. So these types of cues are biasing us in ways that we don't really realize and aren't necessarily paying attention to, but could lead to evolutionary changes in our ability to use perhaps new types of information. Perhaps we start to use visual cues in new ways, or we start to rely on other types of cues for making mate choice decisions.
Okay, now, on the other end of the spectrum, some people say that evolution has stopped for the most part, because of course we no longer have things like Australia. Australia was a bottleneck. It was a continent that broke off, and animals on that continent had a limited mating choice. And so evolution accelerated in Australia. That's why we have marsupials and kangaroos. But we no longer have these bottlenecks anymore. In fact, we have airplanes. And with airplanes, we can cut across any bottleneck. And so as a consequence, evolution has stopped. Plus the fact that for the most part, if you're middle class, you no longer have to worry about where your next meal is going to come from. Therefore, you're not going to choose your mate choice on that basis. So what are your thoughts about those people who think that what you see today is what you see tomorrow?
Yeah, I'm so glad you asked, because this was one of the main motivations for me to write my book, Future Humans, because the idea that human evolution came to an end has been fairly widespread up until recently. And what I wanted to do in the book is to basically lay out all of the evidence that currently exists that I think convincingly shows that evolution has not ended and that has continued up until modern times and is still playing out today. So there's really three main lines of evidence that I go through in the book that show that human evolution is still happening. One of those is genetic and genomic information. So when we sequence the human genome, all of the DNA that makes up the instruction manual for how to make a living organism, we can actually see the telltale signature of natural selection. It actually leaves a mark in the DNA, and we can look for that signature in our DNA and actually ask what types of genes are being affected by natural selection. And we can then get information about how natural selection has been affecting us in the past. So that's one piece of information. The other piece of information that shows that our evolution has continued comes from population databases. So a great example of this is churches. Churches tend to keep records of births, deaths, and marriages. And that information can be used by evolutionary biologists to reconstruct not only the relationships among individual people, but also the age at which women start having children. And it turns out that the age at which women start having children has actually been under natural selection. It's been evolving.
With us today is Professor Scott Solomon. He's a professor at Rice University in Texas in the Department of Biosciences. So, Scott, where we left off, we were talking about the fact that most people would say that evolution has pretty much stopped because, well, if you're middle class, you can always have kids. There's no selection pressure being placed on you. And for that matter, there are no bottlenecks like Australia. We can have airplanes that can cut across all bottlenecks. And with computer dating, we can cut across all sorts of different kinds of bottlenecks. So what are your thoughts?
Right. So the simplest way to think about how evolution is still affecting our species today is to recognize that people have different numbers of children. And as long as that is true, there will always be an opportunity for natural selection to operate. Because whichever traits make it more likely that a person has a few more children than the other people in their population, those traits will become more common in future generations. And that's really what natural selection is. And so there have been studies that have demonstrated that this is still happening. So I was starting to talk about how church records can actually be used to get get at this information. What we can see from church records, from records of birth, deaths, and marriages, is that on average, women who start having children earlier in life tend to have more children over the span of their lifetimes. So what that means is that natural selection tends to favor women who start having children at a younger age because they tend to pass on more copies of their genes to later generations. And so this is interesting because in many societies, including in the United States, women are tending to wait to start having families. So that actually represents a great example of how natural selection can be pulling on a trait in one direction, favoring earlier start to families, and society and culture can be pulling on that same trait in the opposite direction, encouraging a later start to families. So it's really not true that natural selection and evolution has stopped for us. It's merely changed the factors that are influencing the number of children that we have and also how long we survive. Those factors are being influenced by our modern lives. So
okay,
another example.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Go on.
Oh, I was just going to say that another example of evidence for this actually comes from large-scale biomedical studies. So the Framingham Heart Study is a great example of this. It began in the 1940s in Framingham, Massachusetts, right outside of Boston. And they've been following the same cohort of people to just monitor their health since the 1940s. And they've also recruited other cohorts of people who are the children of the original cohort. So what that does is it gives evolutionary biologists the ability to look at what are the factors that are associated with people that tend to have more children versus those that tend to have less children. And they've identified certain characteristics. So some of them are a little bit more intuitive, like having a total lower cholesterol level, tends to be healthier. And so those people tend to survive longer and have more opportunities to reproduce. But there have been some other factors that have been linked in that study that I also talk about in the book
itself. With us today is Professor Scott Solomon, professor of biosciences at Rice University in Texas. The book is called Future Humans: Inside the Science of Our Continuing Evolution. Now, some people say that sperm counts have been declining among men, while female fertility rates have been rising. Now, talking about males, the Y chromosome, some people say, has been getting smaller and smaller over the millennia. And some people even predict that one day, the Y chromosome, which defines men, will disappear. So maybe in the future, we won't have men anymore. But what are your thoughts about the disappearing Y chromosome and the declining sperm count?
Yeah, this is a really fascinating phenomenon, and it's actually not unique to humans. So we've actually been able to observe the same process playing out in other species in which the Y chromosome gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And it has occurred in some other species that the Y chromosome actually ceases to exist. It actually disappears. But interestingly, what happens in those species is not that they stop having males. What actually happens is the genes that are responsible for making a male, which in our species and many others is on the Y chromosome, that gene actually ends up getting sort of copied and pasted onto a different chromosome. So in effect, a different chromosome becomes the chromosome that makes a male a male. And so we believe that if that process were to play out in humans, something similar would take place, that it wouldn't result in, the disappearance of males. It would just transfer the genes for maleness from the Y chromosome to one of the other chromosomes. But the declining fertility is something that is quite concerning. And so we're seeing a rise in couples seeking fertility treatment across much of the world. And this has evolutionary consequences because it could reach a point at which the assisted reproductive technologies that are used to treat couples who are hoping to start a family, we could actually, as a species, become more and more dependent on those technologies, which which by itself isn't necessarily problematic as long as those technologies continue to exist. We'd like to hope that we'll continue to develop new and better ways to treat infertility. But it could actually affect us from an evolutionary point of view if we get to a point where we really need to have those technologies in order to conceive a child.
Okay, now shifting gears and talk about women. You mentioned that in the future, women may no longer experience menopause. Now, menopause is that time of life, usually in the 50s and 60s, when women no longer can have children anymore. But you're talking about the future with no menopause? Explain.
Yeah, so menopause is actually one of those fascinating aspects of human biology that is really almost unique. It is very unusual if we look across the tree of life at other species to find a species in which the ability to reproduce stops, but that individual's lifetime continues. So why it's hard to imagine from an evolutionary point of view why natural selection would ever favor the inability to continue to reproduce. If evolution is all about passing your genes on to the next generation, why would you ever reach a point in your life when you're unable to reproduce? So one of the theories for why menopause first evolved in humans is basically related to the fact that human childbirth is relatively dangerous compared to other species, and this is going back to what we talked about earlier with the human head being so large and having to fit through the birth canal. So as women age, the risks associated with childbirth continue to increase. It gets more and more dangerous to the mother. And so at some point, it is actually more beneficial from an evolutionary point of view for these women to start investing.
Scott, we have to take another short commercial break. So we are talking about the future of the human race. Well, one thing we didn't touch upon, which you touch upon in your book, is the question of birth control. Contraception. For the first time in human history, just within the last several decades, we've been able to alter the whole course of the human race with contraception. How has that changed evolution, if at all?
Right. So one of the interesting things about how contraception birth control has affected our evolution has to do with mate choice decisions. As we were talking about earlier, Darwin recognized that when females choose their partners, that has a big influence on which genes get passed on to the next generation. And so those choices have the traits that females choose in their partners is one of the most important traits for evolution. And we talked about how odor, smell, is one of the traits that we know in humans has been used in making mate choice decisions. This is related to contraception and birth control because studies have shown that women who are taking hormonal birth control pills lose the ability to use smell as a way of getting information about men. So it seems that like online dating, this is one of the ways in which modern life is affecting our ability to use the cues that our ancestors evolved to be able to make sort of informed mate choice decisions.
Okay, now also in your book, you talk about the far future when we might be able to edit our genes deliberately. We have something called CRISPR technology, which allows scientists to actually tinker with the genome directly. And so what are your thoughts? What are your thoughts about what happens when in the future we can have designer children and people will be able to choose the direction of their children genetically?
Yeah, so this is one of the possible ways in which our evolutionary future could really go in a completely different direction compared to anything that we've seen in our evolutionary past. And so the ability, the technology to do this actually already exists. As you mentioned, the CRISPR technology is already being used in research laboratories around the world to make precise, deliberate changes to DNA. But the reason that this could have evolutionary consequences is if we make changes to the DNA of cells that are going to be passed on to later generations. So if we edit the DNA of sperm or egg cells, those changes get passed on to the next generation, which will then pass them on to the subsequent generation, and so on. So what this means is that we have, in theory, the ability to actually guide or control our own evolution. So this could mean that, for example, we can eliminate certain genetic diseases like sickle cell disease, which is caused by just a single DNA base pair change. A single letter in the DNA alphabet can be edited and changed to eliminate that disease. However, it could also bring about other types of changes. You mentioned designer babies. This is something that people have talked about for many years, but we're close to being able to actually do this, for better or for worse. In other words, we could choose the hair color, the eye color, and other types of attributes that don't necessarily have anything to do with survival or well-being, and they could be passed on to later generations. But we really need to understand more about our own genetics, about how these genes operate, before we can get to a point where we can be comfortable making changes without having any unintended consequences.
Now, every parent would like to get the smart gene to give to their children. However, some psychologists say that there could be hundreds, maybe thousands of genes involved in the so-called smartness of a human being. And so perhaps we're going to go overboard and have a wild goose chase finding genes for which there's no single gene, but maybe hundreds of genes that control smartness and intelligence. What are your thoughts?
Yes, that's exactly what I was alluding to earlier. So I gave the example of sickle cell disease as being something that we understand is caused by only not only a single gene, but a single DNA letter that is changed. But that is a very unusual situation. Most traits that we are aware of, and intelligence is one of those traits, is not determined by just a single gene, but as you mentioned, often by hundreds or even thousands of genes. And each one of those genes by itself has only a really small effect on the actual trait, like intelligence. So first of all, we would need to better understand what each one of those genes is. We would need to understand what precise changes to make, but we also need to be sure that those genes aren't having any other effect in the body. Very often, a single gene has genes. What they do in the body is they make proteins, and those proteins can go on and do all different sorts of things. It's often more than just one role that they play in the body. So we need to make sure we understand not only how each of those genes contributes to intelligence, but also what other roles those genes might play in the body.
And wouldn't it be almost impossible to stop the spread of certain genes that are illegal? I mean, we cannot stop the flow of drugs. Genes are information. You can send that on the internet. It's just a coding of ATCG, and you can send it right on the internet as pure information. So wouldn't it be in the future a problem if certain genes are considered illegal because they're too dangerous or whatever? But how do you stop it, given the fact we can barely stop the drug trade? Did you know that the things you see on Harry Potter, the things you see in the movies, some of the stuff we can do, for example, telepathy, reading minds, projecting thoughts, we can do that today. And who's funding it? The United States Pentagon, of course. And also telekinesis, the ability to move objects with the mind. In fact, one day I think the internet will become BrainNet. We will mentally send emotions, feelings, memories on the internet. That's going to replace television. It'll replace the movies. And we'll have instantaneous communication with our fellow human beings mentally. So find out what all the excitement is about. In my previous book, Physics of the Impossible, I talk about stuff that's way, way out there. We're talking about teleportation, starships, invisibility. We're talking about all the stuff you see in Star Trek, decomposed and put together in a form that you can understand. So the book is called The Physics of the Impossible. And so once again, if you want to get on Science Fantastic,
What's the hesitation? Call 612-564-8135, and perhaps your thoughts will be heard on about 100 radio stations that carry Science Fantastic. Okay, well, moving right along, why don't we take the first listener phone call?
Hello, good evening. My name is Edwin Velez. I'm calling you from WTAW via TuneIn. My question is concerning the universe. I feel at times, and I may be wrong, the universe could be like a living something, sort of like we are. You know, we are born and eventually we die. Like everything living, born, you know, fruits, everything lives and then eventually dies. Even in space, the stars are born and they eventually die. So going back to what you were saying about dark matter and dark energy, you know, what we can't see, we know there's a force out there, dark energy, and we know the universe is expanding, you know, galaxies are expanding. Can you relate that in some way to how everything else that's living sort of starts small and expands? Thank you, Doctor.
Well, you asked something that has tantalized philosophers and physicists for many a century. And the question is, well, what is life? What does it mean to be living? And for that matter, can rocks be living? Can the universe be living? Can things that we once considered to be inanimate, can they be alive? In fact, that was the subject of a major science fiction novel by Fred Hoyle. Fred Hoyle was one of the great cosmologists of the 20th century. He proposed the steady state theory in opposition to the Big Bang theory. And he wrote a book called The Black Cloud, where the gigantic nebula from outer space actually visits the Earth, and much to our shock, we find out that it's conscious. We can actually engage in a conversation with this gigantic cloud. And what is the cloud doing? It's on its way to understand the beginning of the universe. And so we caught it mid-flight. As it goes through outer space, the cloud wants to understand the origin of the universe. Well, first of all, it depends on what you mean by living. First of all, does that mean life cycle? If so, then the universe itself has a life cycle. It was born in fire. That is, it was born in this titanic explosion called the Big Bang. And it may eventually die in ice. Now, we physicists think that there are four stages to the life cycle of our universe. Stage one was this horrendous explosion that took place. It was too hot for atoms to form. Every time an atom would form, it would be ripped apart by heat. So that was the first era of the universe. We live in the second era. The second era is called the stellariferous era. In other words, the era of stars. Atoms began to condense. Hydrogen fused and lit up the universe. So the universe as we know it is in stage two. But let's face it, all things must pass. We go into stage three. In stage three, the stars begin to blink out. Our sun, for example, will eventually die when it uses up its nuclear fuel and dies as a piece of nuclear waste floating in outer space. That's stage three. Stage four is when the universe consists just of black holes and neutron stars. It's a very cold, dark universe out there. Stars don't shine anymore. It's very cold. And that's stage four. Then we hit stage five. At that point, even the protons themselves begin to decay. The entire universe becomes a mist. A cold, freezing mist of electrons and neutrinos. That's the final stage in this life cycle. Now, are there ways to change that life cycle? Well, yeah. Perhaps we're not going to end in fire. Perhaps we'll end in fire rather than ice. And that's called the Big Crunch. Some people believe that after a period of expansion, the universe will stop and begin to contract. As it contracts, stars begin to merge with each other, things start to get really hot, and then bang, the universe bangs once again. That's called the oscillating universe, the fact that our universe could have multiple bangs. So is that possible? Well, yeah, because we don't know the far future of the universe. Where are we today? we are in stage two, and the universe is just, well, it just keeps on expanding. It's in a runaway mode. We thought that we would see the contraction of the universe, but nope, the universe keeps on accelerating. In fact, we call it the accelerating universe. Well, before the break, we had a rather cosmic question, and that is the universe alive? Well, the universe has a life cycle, as we mentioned. It has a birth, it has a maturation, and eventually it'll have a death. But is it conscious? Well, believe it or not, we physicists are not quite sure about this question. It goes back to something that we call quantum mechanics. That is the theory of the atom itself. Now, I teach quantum mechanics. I teach in the graduate program here at the university. And when I teach here at the college, I teach them that there is a debate. There is a debate that goes to the very heart of reality itself. Einstein hated this reality, but hey, what can I say? Einstein was wrong in this question. The quantum theory has withstood every challenge ever since it was proposed in 1925 by Heisenberg and Schrodinger. And it goes to this. How do you know the state of a cat? A cat could be either dead or alive in a box. Until you open the box, you don't know whether a cat is dead or alive. However, before you open the box, how do you describe the cat? We describe the cat as the sum total of all possible states of a cat. Dead, alive, asleep, awake, jumping up and down. And that may sound crazy, but you have to open the box to make an observation to understand the state of the cat. Now, you may say to yourself, this is crazy. You're telling me that the state of a cat exists or whether or not there's somebody there to observe it? Observation determines existence? That's crazy. It goes back to the philosophical question. If a tree falls in a forest and there's no one there to listen to the tree, did the tree really fall? Well, the average person would say, of course, stupid. I mean, if a tree falls in the forest and there's nobody there to watch the tree, of course it fell. However, in quantum mechanics, you have to observe it to determine its particular state. This works for electrons. Electrons exist in multiple states. And what's the application of this? The transistor. That's why transistors make the internet possible. That's why we have laser beams. Laser beams are possible because of this curious fact that electrons can exist in multiple states simultaneously. Now, Einstein thought this was horrible. This is incredibly wrong, he thought. He thought it was downright stupid. However, what can I say? Einstein was wrong in this question. Now, here is the rub. Okay, here's the key to the question. Who makes the observation? Well, a human, right? But humans are conscious. Consciousness requires, observation requires consciousness. This means that consciousness, in some sense, determines existence. Now, at this point, Einstein blew up and said, this is really stupid. And he thought that, well, quantum mechanics is undeniably successful, especially in the laboratory, but the more successful it gets, he said, quote, the sillier it looks. Now, there's several ways to resolve this paradox. One way to resolve the paradox is to assume that cosmic consciousness exists. Somebody has to make an observation for existence to take place. In other words, the universe may be conscious. The universe makes an observation, and that's why things exist. However, there's another way around it, which I lean toward, and it's even crazier. An even crazier way to resolve this question. And just remember, the Nobel Prize winners debate this question. You can go to any room, ask two Nobel Prize winners their understanding of the cat problem, and you'll probably get two different answers. The other answer, which many of my friends lean toward, and they are Nobel laureates, the other position is that the universe has split in half. That's right. The universe itself has split in half. In one universe, the cat is dead. In another universe, the cat is alive. And the universe is constantly splitting apart. So you now have a choice. If you want to become a quantum physicist, the two main choices are A, some kind of cosmic consciousness exists that determines existence, or in one universe you have dead cats, in another universe you have live cats, and the universe keeps on splitting. Now, if you think that we physicists are now totally nuts and have lost our marbles, well, just remember that some of the greatest minds of all time, Schrodinger, Heisenberg, Einstein, they debated this question. They debated the question for decades, and believe it or not, we still debate this question. You can go to any physics conference on the world and strike up a conversation and get into an argument about the Schrodinger cat problem. Okay, well, let's move on now to maybe something more concrete. Let's take the next listener phone call.
Sue, Muldoon, Alaska, KFQD. Dr. Kopku, about 1859, you talked about the massive solar storm and the effects that happened on the telegraphs and the possibility of having another massive storm again and how that would shut major systems down. Is this something that a Faraday case could solve for personal property like radios and possibly some of these small generators you can buy now? Is a Faraday case something that could protect some of the modern electronics that people are getting? Just curious. Enjoying the aurora in Alaska. Thank you.
Well, the short answer to your question is yes, a Faraday cage would indeed give you some kind of protection. But let me give you some background to this very important question. As we said before on Science Fantastic, in 1859, an event took place which could have altered the course of civilization itself. However, in 1859, there was no internet. We didn't have electric dynamos, radio, television, none of that. All we had back then in 1859 was telegraph wires. Well, a man named Carrington, he was a British astronomer, he was looking at the energy of the sun, and he noticed a huge, humongous solar flare that emerged from the sun. It was historic. You've never seen anything like that. And sure enough, a few hours to days afterwards, when the solar wind finally hit the planet Earth, 93 million miles away, there were short circuits. Fires, in fact, started in telegraph depots around the world. And the northern lights went berserk. You could go to Cuba. The people in Cuba said that they were reading the newspaper at night and they looked up and saw the northern lights. Now that's really weird. The northern lights you only see in the north. That is, if you go to Scandinavia or the North Pole, you can see the northern lights. And there it was in Latin America. Now, we physicists today, given those two facts, we can now reconstruct, using Maxwell's equations, exactly how powerful that solar flare was. And we realize, oh my God, if that solar flare were to happen today, property damage would be, according to one estimate by physicists, $2 trillion. That's trillion with a T, not trillion with a B. We're talking about blackouts taking place in power stations around the Earth. We're talking about blackouts in outer space. Satellites would be burnt out. In fact, on the space station, we have to actually warn our astronauts about incoming solar flares that may cause problems. Well, before the break, we had a call. And the call was asking about the Carrington event of 1859, when a gigantic coronal mass discharge left the sun, hit the planet Earth, and caused a solar storm around the atmosphere that we've never seen before. The northern lights were seen as far as Cuba. Think about that. The people in Cuba looking up and seeing the northern lights. So, what would happen today if we had another Northern Lights? Power stations would be wiped out. Blackouts. Blackouts around the entire North America. We would have power stations blown out and satellites, communication satellites that carry the internet, weather reports, television, they would go on the blink. astronauts would have to be warned, and civilization as we know it would be thrown back perhaps 100 years into the past, back to the beginning of the electric age. I had a chance to glimpse a little bit of this when we had a blackout here in Manhattan. And in Times Square, we had hundreds of people who could not use their credit card to get a hotel room. So what do? They had to sleep in the lobbies of all these hotels, these fancy five-star hotels. Now think about that for a moment. If your refrigerator conks out, it means that food will go to room temperature and rot, and you won't be able to have dinner. In fact, food riots. Food riots would spread rapidly because food cannot be stored in refrigerators anymore. So Wall Street comes to a halt. Banking transactions cannot be made. Emergency crews, firemen, and police, they're paralyzed because there's no communication possible. The internet is down. Radio, television is down. And the gentleman asked, well, can you build a Faraday cage to protect yourself? Well, the answer is yes, but the cage would have to be pretty big. Sometimes in science fairs, you see the gentleman, a scientist, go into a large metal cage. That's called the Faraday cage. It was Faraday himself, 150 years ago, who would build these cages, electrify them, and dazzle audiences because all the electricity went to the outside perimeter of the cage, and the man inside was warm as toast. Didn't feel a thing. No shocks, no problems inside the Faraday cage. So a Faraday cage is a metal cage that completely encapsulates you, and you actually have one in your kitchen. Look at your microwave oven. Your microwave oven is covered with metal. It is a Faraday cage, and all the electrical impulses are concentrated inside the Faraday cage. And so, yes, that's one way to protect yourself, but another way to protect yourself is to ask Congress to pass a bill, just a few $100 million, to prevent $2 trillion in property damage. We could reinforce, create shielding for power plants on the planet Earth. We can build redundancy systems for satellites. You know, over 100 years ago, we had a young gentleman of the age of 16 who asked himself a children's question that changed the course of modern history. He asked himself a simple question. Can you outrace a light beam? Such a dumb question. Well, that child was Albert Einstein. And it took 10 years before he finally figured out how to answer this children's question. Can you outrace a light beam? And the answer is no, because all the energy that goes into accelerating up to a light beam turns into a mass. You just get heavier and heavier, not faster and faster. So how much energy was turned into matter? Well, you can calculate it. It is E equals MC squared. In other words, the solution to a children's problem eventually gave birth to the atomic bomb and our understanding of why the stars shine and why the sun bathes the planet Earth in sunlight. Not bad for a 16-year-old child who changed the course of modern history by asking a children's question, and that is, can you outrace a light beam? So why don't you ask me a question? Give us a call. The hotline number is 612-564-8135. Now, before the break, we had a question about the Carrington event, and that is a gigantic solar flare from the sun will paralyze everything on the planet Earth electrically and send us back maybe 100 years into the past. And the question is, how often are they, and what would happen if it happened today? Well, we physicists made a study, $2 trillion in property damage if we have another Carrington event. And how often are they? Well, we don't know. However, when you go to the North Pole, dig into the ice, you could recreate the conditions of the atmosphere of the Earth thousands of years ago, not just hundreds, but thousands of years ago. And they went back to 1859, and sure enough, you can see a disturbance a disturbance in the chemical composition of the ice of 1859. And then you look for previous ones, and then hopefully you can calculate the periodicity. That is, how often do we have these gigantic solar flares which can paralyze all of modern civilization? Well, it turns out there was another Carrington event, we think, before then. It happened roughly 200 years before then. So we think that on a scale of 100 years or so, we have these paralyzing events that can change the course of human history. In other words, we're due for one. We're due for another Carrington event. Now, I was reading about this the other day, and I was kind of shocked to find out that these solar flares actually periodically miss the planet Earth. They don't hit us. A direct hit is rather rare. We had a direct hit in 1859, but near misses take place rather frequently. We had a near miss just a few decades ago. In other words, we almost bit the bullet back then. So a word to the wise, let's start the process of funding, creating backup systems, shielding, Faraday cages for our electronics, or else we too might be sent 100 years into the past. Okay, let's move on now to take the next listener phone call.
This is Wiley Slane, listening on KUAC-FM, Fairbanks, Alaska. I have a question for you about evolution. In the grand scheme of evolution, how come some predators and prey, for that matter, have poor vision? Wouldn't their vision get better and better after every generation in order to succeed? Thank you very much.
Well, the answer is yes. Take a look at the octopus, for example. The octopus hunts on the bottom of the ocean. Its eyesight is rather poor. Okay, let's move on now and take the next listener phone call.
Hi, Dr. Kaku. This is John Eganoff. I listened to your show on KFBX in Fairbanks, Alaska. And here's the question I have for you. If the universe turns out to be a cyclically expanding and contracting universe, would there be any measure of entropy that survives a contraction stage that would allow someone to know in the following expanding phase that it wasn't the first expansion? In other words, does any measure of entropy survive a contraction cycle and make its way into the following expansion cycle? Thank you very much. Enjoy your show.
Well, believe it or not, you ask a question that many physicists are asking right now. So let me try to explain. First of all, many scientists believe that perhaps the Big Bang was a quantum event, in which case it could happen again and again and again. In fact, maybe Big Bangs are happening all the time. And for example, perhaps our universe had a bang and perhaps it will bang again. It will perhaps oscillate. And then the question is, how do you test such an idea? Well, you say to yourself, it seems to be impossible, because after you have a bang and a collapse, all the information is lost from the previous bang. So is it possible, therefore, to make a calculation that can predict where we are in this cycle of bangs? Well, believe it or not, the answer is yes. We can calculate the amount of disorder in the universe. Entropy is a measure of disorder. It's a measure of chaos. So there's what we call the second law of thermodynamics, which says that entropy always increases in an open system. And as a consequence, we want to calculate the entropy of our universe. And we find the entropy of our universe is rather low, astonishingly low. And some people say, aha, this means that we are early in the cycle of universes, that maybe in the next cycle, the universe will pick up more entropy, and we just happen to be early in the cycle. Now, at first, you may say to yourself, this is nuts. You physicists are talking about universes before universes, the multiverse of universes, when we can't even figure out our universe. Already, you're dabbling in a multiverse of universes. Well, yeah, we physicists are, because we're curious about why we had the Big Bang. The Big Bang was a rather crazy event. We don't know why it banged. We don't know if it's going to bang again. And that's what we come up with these crazy theories to try to understand the nature of the Big Bang itself. Now, we know there was a bang. We know there was an expansion, but we don't know why it banged. We don't know how it banged. We don't know why it banged the way it did. All we know is that it did bang. One telltale sign is to calculate entropy. Entropy should perhaps increase after every cycle, and therefore by measuring the entropy in our universe, the disorder in our universe, we can tell how old it is on a scale of universes. So believe it or not, we physicists are working on this. We have no resolution to the question at the present time. You may say to yourself that, my God, you physicists have too much time on your hands dabbling in multiverses of universes which cannot be measured. But hey, we are physicists. We like to measure things. And one thing that we would like to measure is whether or not we exist in a multiverse of universes. That's one of the hottest topics now in cosmology. Okay, let's move on now to the next listener phone call.
Dr. Michio Cocker, this is Curtis in Fairbanks. Call letters KCBF. And I'm wanting to build islands out of the molten lava off these volcanoes, such as Hawaii, and take these miles-long islands and pull them down to where they're needed to protect the coastlines or rehabilitate the corals. And what a massive adventure it would be. I know that it's possible because I've seen the islands floating in the southern hemisphere. I appreciate your comments. Thank you.
If I understand you correctly, you're talking about geoengineering. That is, we see these volcanoes, we see gigantic geological activity on the planet Earth, and we say to ourselves, well, why can't we harness? Why can't we alter the course of geology on the planet Earth? Well, it sounds like a great idea, but you realize that we humans are like tiny little insects on this gigantic ball called the Earth, and we simply don't have the energy or the technology to do so. Now, when I was in high school, I had an advisor, Edward Teller. He was the father of the hydrogen bomb. And he did have ideas about altering the geology of the planet Earth with hydrogen bombs. He wanted to use hydrogen bombs to dig canals, to dig dams, to do geoengineering of the planet Earth. Kaku, I'm a professor of theoretical physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And in this hour, we're going to throw the lines open because, hey, this is your hour. Are you sick and tired of simply listening to the TV and listening to the radio and not being able to interact with the host? Well, here is your chance to get even. Give us a call. The hotline number, write this down. The hotline number is 612-564-8135. Once again, it's 612-564-8135. You can also go to my website and ask the question directly off the website. Website is mkaku.org, mkaku.org. And again, leave your name, call letters of the radio station or website you're listening to, and the city you're calling from, and then ask away. Here's your chance. Here's your chance to ask that question that you've always been waiting to ask but never had the opportunity. You know, years ago, I was on a book tour, and a person came up to me after the lecture, and he says, "Professor, you have got to answer my question." And I said, "Well, gee, why? Why do I have to answer your question?" And he said, "Please, please, it's because if you don't answer my question, it will be another 10 years before a theoretical physicist comes by this town to answer this same question." And I thought to myself, and I said, "He's right. I mean, how many theoretical physicists are there in the United States? There are not that many of us. For example, how many of us do string theory? Oh, about 100. That's it. out of a population of almost a third of a billion in this country. There are only about 100 of us that work on the unified field theory. Well, anyway, here is your chance to ask that question, no matter how complicated or obscure it is. Chances are, if you have that dumb question, chances are scores of other people have the identical same question, but are simply too embarrassed to ask. Well, you can ask that question on Science Fantastic, because sometimes the dumbest questions are the most profound questions of all. Years ago, there was a gentleman who was walking down a country road, and he saw the moon, and he saw an apple fall. And then he asked himself a stupid question, and that is, if an apple falls, does the moon also fall? He thought about it, and he said, yes, the moon is in free fall. It doesn't hit the Earth, because of course it rotates around the Earth, but yeah, the moon is in free fall. In fact, almost everything is in free fall. Unless something is sitting on the floor or resting on something, yeah, everything is in free fall. Walking is free fall. This young man's name was Isaac Newton, and he initiated what we call the Industrial Revolution by writing down the laws of mechanics, the laws of rocket ships, the laws of gravity. A comet sailed over London around that time. Everyone was talking about the comet, including a man named Edmund Halley. He visited Isaac Newton and asked him, "The comet, everyone is talking about the comet. What is it?" And Isaac Newton said, "Oh, that's easy. It's moving in an elliptical orbit. I've been tracking it with my telescope that I recently invented, and it's undergoing an inverse square law." Well, you can imagine that Edmund Halley's jaw hit the floor. I mean, comets were a mystery, an object of superstitious worship. The king must die, people said, when a comet looms overhead. And here was this young man saying he's worked out the trajectory of comets. And they said, this comet is going to come back in 76 years, he predicted. And sure enough, on Christmas Day, 76 years later, when both Edmund Halley and Isaac Newton had passed away, a comet sailed over London, sealing the fame of Isaac Newton. And why was he so famous? In part, because he asked himself a stupid question. Does the moon also fall? He created a mathematics to calculate the falling moon, and that mathematics is called calculus. Okay, let's move on now and take the first listener phone call.
Hi, Dr. Kaku. My name is Jason Sorensen, and I follow you on Twitter. I'm calling from Los Angeles. The question that I have for you that's been on my mind, we talk about dark energy, and I'm trying to wrap my head around this concept. As we look further out into the universe, we see that galaxies are redshifting faster and faster away from us. But as we look further out into the universe, we're also looking further back in time. So doesn't that mean that the expansion of the universe is actually slowing down? Because as we get closer and closer, it's less and less time dilation. Whereas the further out we look, the further back in time we're looking. So just trying to get my head wrapped around dark energy. And hopefully this question makes sense. Thanks.
Okay, well, your question makes sense because it goes to one of the great unsolved problems in all of physics. It goes back to a question asked 2,000 years ago by the Greeks, and that question is, what is the world made of? Well, we used to think for 2,000 years that the universe was made mainly of atoms. Well, that's not true. We now realize that about 4% of the matter energy of the universe is in the form of atoms, that 23% is in the form of dark matter, which is invisible matter, which holds the galaxies together, and 73% is in the form of dark energy, which is what you mentioned. Dark energy is the energy of nothing. It's the energy of the vacuum, which is pushing the galaxies apart. Now, it was Nikola Tesla, who the father of modern electronics, along with Thomas Edison, it was Nikola Tesla who said that it's possible to extract energy from nothing. Well, not quite true, but he was close. Energy from empty space. It turns out that Einstein's equations contain a term called the cosmological constant, which shows that even nothingness has energy associated with it. And this energy is repulsive. It is very faint, but it is sufficient to push the galaxies apart. And that gives us the expanding universe. Therefore, if a yellow star is moving away from us, light is stretched as it comes to the Earth. And when you stretch yellow light, what happens to yellow light? It turns red. And that's called the red shift. And when we look in the heavens, we see that almost uniformly, all the galaxies, except for a few, are moving away from us. This is called the red shift. And we think that what is driving it is dark energy. Now, the question is, how do you predict how much dark energy there is? If you get a sheet of paper and you do the calculation as to what you think dark energy should be, you come up with a number which is off by 10 to the 120. That is 10 raised to the 120 powers. That is 1 with 120 zeros after it. Okay, let's move on now to the next listener phone call.
My name is Harry. I'm calling from Rochester, New York area. I'm listening out of WGVA. And my question is, I want to hear something about harvesting helium from the moon. About a year ago, I was listening to some program, I don't know, but they were talking about going to the moon, and just a few inches under the moon is tons of raw material of HE2 and tons of helium, and that one payload of a space shuttle will actually produce enough non-pollutant energy for the United States for an entire year. So, do you know anything about that? Thanks again.
Well, yes, I'm quite familiar with the calculation you mentioned, but I think the people who made that statement are kind of overstepping what is known. Let's back up. When we go to the moon, people want to know, can we mine the moon? Can we get materials that'll pay for going to the moon? Well, for the most part, the answer is no. It turns out that we know what the moon is made of. The moon was basically blasted out of the Earth about 4 billion years ago. And as a consequence, the chemical composition of the moon is almost identical to that of the Earth. So if you were to mine ores on the moon, it's very expensive. You can simply mine ores in your backyard. You don't have to go to the moon. However, some people think that helium-3 is rare on the Earth and is slightly more plentiful on the moon and could be used in fusion reactors to generate power. Now, great. Hey, I'm all for that. But what's the catch? There's always a catch someplace. The catch is, first of all, fusion reactors don't exist. In fact, we're not even sure they work. In southern France, in Cardache, France, the European Union is basically backing the ITER fusion reactor, the most advanced $10 billion machine on the planet Earth. But unfortunately, it has been delayed once again. The joke is that every 20 years, we physicists claim that we'll have fusion in 20 years. 20 years after that, we make the next claim, give us another 20 years. Well, it's been pushed back again. Now, personally, I think this is the way to go. Personally, I think that one day we will get fusion reactors on the Earth and gradually wean ourselves away from fossil fuels. But that time is not now. And helium-3 requires a fusion process that's even more exotic than the ones being explored by the ITER. So what's the catch? The catch is, first of all, A, we don't really know how much helium-3 the moon has. And B, even if we do find helium-3 on the moon, it may take decades until we finally have a fusion reactor on the Earth which can burn helium-3. Now, most people on the Earth think that seawater is perhaps an easier fuel to get rather than getting helium-3 from the moon. Seawater contains helium, ordinary helium, hydrogen, I'm sorry, and you can fuse hydrogen from seawater to extract energy. So why am I for space travel? Well, as I said before, the economics of mining the moon are iffy. The economics of mining asteroids, however, is possibly a better shot because asteroids have platinum and rare earth elements that are valuable that are not necessarily found plentifully on the planet Earth. You see, when the Earth was molten, many of the heavy elements sunk toward the center of the Earth, like platinum-based materials. In outer space, the asteroids did not go through that process. The asteroids did not come from a planet that was molten, where gravity slowly sucked in the heavy elements. As a consequence, exotic elements are more common in asteroids than the moon. The moon, on the other hand, was blasted out of the Earth about 4 billion years ago. An object about the size of Mars plowed into the Earth and blew out enormous chunk of Earth into space, which eventually coalesced because of gravity into the moon. So once again, yes, you can argue that helium-3 is a goal for the space program, but B, we don't know how much there really is. And most important, we don't have a fusion reactor to burn helium-3. Okay, let's move on now to the next listener phone call.
This is David from Central Lake, Michigan, WMKT. I'd like you to do a discussion of the limits in the universe. We supposedly know the limits of the speed of light. I would ask whether light speeds up if it's a light beam is heading straight into a black hole. Temperature, we understand there's a limit to the low end of the temperature scale, but is there a limit to the high end of it? Is there a limit to the density? We know that if the Big Bang is true, then obviously the black hole reached its limits and exploded. Is there a limit to the number of elements? Is there a limit to the actual space? If the universe is expanding, what is it expanding into? And is there any end to where we can expand into? Is there a limit on the amount of dimensions that is possible? Well, just generally, I'd like you to discuss the limits of physics. Thank you.
Wow, you ask about 10 questions in one. The basic question being, what is the maximum of anything? The maximum temperature, the maximum weight, the maximum density. Is there an upper limit to these parameters? Lower limits, of course, exist. We have hypothetically absolute zero, the lowest temperature you can get. So let's say a few things about that. First of all, the maximum temperature. The hottest temperature we see in the universe comes out of collisions of black holes. However, the question is, can you get bigger and bigger black holes? And the answer seems to be yes. There's no limit to how much mass you can concentrate in a black hole. The black hole M87, which hit the newspapers, that black hole weighs 6.5 billion times the mass of the sun. It basically outweighs a galaxy. One small black hole at the center of the galaxy M87 weighs as much as 6.5 billion suns. Is there an upper limit to this? And for the most part, we see no upper limit. Is there an upper limit to density? Well, if I take the sun, for example, and I were to squeeze the sun, eventually it would become a white dwarf. And eventually the white dwarf would decay into a black dwarf and drift as a piece of nuclear waste. But if you could somehow squeeze that, which is not going to happen, our sun will not turn into a black hole, but if you could squeeze the sun down to about 2 miles across, assuming you could squeeze the sun down to a sphere 2 miles across, it will implode and become a black hole. And so is there a limit to the density of a black hole? And apparently not. You can simply dump more and more materials into a black hole. And then is there the farthest star? Is there a limit to how far you can see with a telescope? Well, actually, there is a limit here. It turns out that the Hubble Space Telescope, peering into outer space, looks into the past, because light takes time to reach your eyeball. And therefore, you've probably seen pictures of it. The farthest galaxy that you could see with a telescope. And then what is beyond the farthest galaxy? Blackness. There is a limit there because you're going backwards in time. So what is this blackness that lies beyond the farthest star? It is the Big Bang itself. Since the Big Bang did not take place mainly in the optical region, but in the microwave region, that's why it's black. Okay, let's move on now to the next listener phone call.
Hi, Dr. Kaku. My name is Jay, and I'm calling from New York City. I'm listening to your broadcast through the internet. Anyway, I've read several of your books, and I've really enjoyed them. I think your writing is very clear and speaks perfectly to the audience. I love that. My question involves quantum entanglement, and I'm wondering if you think someday that it will be used for, could be used for communications. For example, I believe it takes like 20 minutes now to get a communication to the rover between Earth and Mars, but if quantum entanglement could be used, that 20 minutes could be eliminated. It would be virtually instantaneous. And I appreciate your work. Bye-bye.
Well, if you're a Star Trek fan, you know that the Captain Kirk can talk to Federation headquarters instantly, faster than the speed of light, by using something called subspace communications, communications through subspace. Now, what is that? Maybe it's quantum entanglement. However, there are problems there. Personally, I think that one way to really communicate faster than the speed of light is through a wormhole. But again, to harness the energy of a wormhole, you have to be able to harness the energy of a black hole, which is very difficult. But let's talk about quantum entanglement. If I have two electrons are vibrating, and let's say you make them touch and they vibrate together in unison. Then you separate them. When you separate them, an invisible umbilical cord emerges connecting these two electrons, such that if you jiggle one electron, then the other electron, faster than the speed of light, is aware of the fact that its partner is being jiggled. So, for example, let's say I have two electrons, one spinning up, one spinning down, like a top. When I separate them, and I measure the spin of the first electron, it is spinning up. Then what is the spin of the second electron? Down. And that information travels faster than the speed of light. Well, there's a catch there. Let's take a short commercial break. And after the break, I'll talk about the catch involved with quantum entanglement. If we could do it, we could talk faster than the speed of light. Okay, once again, you're listening to Science Fantastic. Give us a call at 612-564-8135, and maybe you can get on national radio.
Warning, if you're drowning in debt you can't afford, do not let the credit card companies trick you into thinking that you have to pay it all back, because you don't. What the credit card companies don't want you to know is that there's actually a way to get debt-free without paying off your entire debt or going bankrupt. If you have $10,000 or more in credit card debt, you now have the right to let us settle that debt for a fraction of what you owe. For free information, call Credit Associates now. 1-800-976-1460. We'll even show you how much money you could save. If you can't afford to pay off all your debt, do not let the credit card companies trick you into thinking that you have to. Call Credit Associates now for free information on how to get debt-free faster than you ever thought possible without debt consolidation or bankruptcy. We depend on your success and offer a guarantee, so there's no risk. For free information, call now. 1-800-976-1460. That's 1-800-976-1460. 1-800-976-1460.
What would your life be like if you woke up each morning with new vitality, feeling better than you have in years, and you noticed a difference in your sleeping patterns, blood sugar levels, and had a sense of well-being overall? There's something that is changing thousands of people's lives, and you could be one of them. It's called Heart and Body Extract. Sharon Harris, co-creator of Heart and Body Extract, talks about the positive effects of Heart and Body Extract.
What happens with the formula Heart and Body Extract is it's giving the body the necessary vitamins, minerals, amino acids, enzymes, and phytonutrients so the body will heal itself. And yes, the body does have the ability to balance blood pressure, balance cholesterol, clean and unclog the arteries. It can also work on balancing the circulation for diabetics. So the body is an amazing thing. It simply needs some help so it has the tools to heal itself.
Heart and Body Extract gets results. To order your 2-month supply, call now, toll free at 866-295-5305. Order online at hbextract.com.
Would you like to get back that full head of hair from years past? Introducing Reveal from GCNLife.com. Beverly Hills dermatologist Dr. Nathan Newman invented Reveal, which contains polypeptides with natural botanicals and no parabens, sulfates, silicones, or dyes for a salon-quality hair growth product, Reveal. Here's Dr. Newman.
I have treated a lot of patients who lose their hair and they lose their confidence. We've created a unique set of polypeptides, which we call HPT6. The HPT6 contains the polypeptides from 6 different plants. The scalp infusion treatment should be used on wet or dry scalp. The Reveal hair care system is designed to be used for men and women alike.
Get Reveal at GCNLife.com with a 30-day money-back guarantee. So try Reveal today at GCNLife.com or 844-443-6637. Plus a discount up to 25% off for Reveal at GCNLife.com or 844-443-6637.
This is Science Fantastic.
Welcome back to Science Fantastic with Professor Michio Kaku. On Science Fantastic, we take your questions, any and all questions about the cutting edge of science. And here's your chance to get on national radio to share your thoughts. Before the break, we had a question about quantum entanglement. To talk to a person on Mars takes about 20 minutes. If you have somebody on Pluto, it would take you 8 hours to a day to send a message to Pluto. To send a message to the nearby stars would take 4 years minimum. And so is there a way to communicate faster than the speed of light? Well, one possibility is wormholes, but that requires a fantastic amount of energy. Another possibility is quantum entanglement. Einstein was wrong on this one. Einstein said that nothing can go faster than the speed of light. Information from one electron to the other cannot travel faster than the speed of light, but quantum entanglement has been measured. We've done this in the laboratory. And bingo, if you jiggle one electron, its partner feels the effect of that jiggling faster than the speed of light. On this question, Einstein was wrong. We know that because we can duplicate this in the laboratory. So you may say to yourself, well, if that's so great, how come we don't have subspace communicators? Why can't we communicate with our space probes faster than the speed of light? Well, there's a catch. There's always a catch someplace. That catch is that, yes, some form of information traveled between one electron to the electron faster than the speed of light. The problem is that information was random. It was chaotic. It was useless. Now, Morse code, on the other hand, is not useless. When you send Morse code, each code corresponds to a letter. Letters correspond to words, words correspond to concepts. That means you can send net information on Morse code. However, when you send information with quantum entanglement, what do you get? You get gibberish. So it's not useful. So at the present time, the only known way of possibly communicating faster than the speed of light is through a wormhole, which requires vast amounts of energy, stellar energy. But quantum entanglement, well, we can do it in the laboratory. We can send information faster than light, but it is useless information. Sorry about that. Okay, let's move on to the next listener phone call.
My name is Malcolm McLean. I'm in the Finger Lakes area of New York. It's 1240 WBBA. And the question is, I thought 2 years ago out of Brookhaven, they were attempting to do an experiment where they would generate a minuscule black hole. And, of course, everybody was worried if we did something like that, could we generate a black hole that would run away? Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, I think I am partially responsible for the incorrectness of that idea. Years ago, I was talking to a producer at the Science Fiction Channel, and I mentioned, ha ha ha, that we're building this accelerator in Geneva, Switzerland, the Large Hadron Collider, and some people think that maybe there could be a runaway reaction, maybe there could be a black hole could be created in that machine. And then I was careful to say that it's not going to happen. Well, the producer from the Science Fiction Channel, his eyes lit up, and sure enough, without my permission or whatever, he ran with the idea and did a program where an accelerator created a black hole with all sorts of monstrous effects. Well, the idea is out there. If you saw the latest Spider-Man cartoon about entering the Spider-Verse, you realize that the whole Spider-Verse of parallel universe Spider-Man was unleashed by a particle accelerator. Well, first of all, let me set the story straight. To create a wormhole, you need the energy of a black hole. And a black hole would require the energy of a star. We are nowhere near being able to create the energy of a star with the Large Hadron Collider. Second, even if you could do that, in outer space, we see cosmic rays. Cosmic rays with more energy than can be created with our puny pea shooters called the Large Hadron Collider. And hey, we're still here. Okay, moving on. Let's take the next listener phone call.
Hi, Dr. Michio Kaku. I'm Vincent Michi, and I'm calling from New London, Minnesota. It's easy to understand that there are three spatial dimensions, and this fourth singular dimension of time. Gravity is bestowed by Higgs boson particle, in a sense, and then it gives mass, which is what I understand right now. I'm interested if there was some small quantum particle that would denote time, the passage of time. If this is true, would time be unique to each individual particle? Would they each have their own unique time? Similar, but different. I'm wondering what your thoughts are about that, Doctor. Thank you.
Okay, well, you ask a question about the nature of reality itself. And, well, we have Einstein's theory, which gives us the most advanced understanding of space and time. First of all, you ask whether or not each particle has a clock associated with it. Well, there is one version of quantum mechanics where you can do that. However, it's not necessary. That is, time is everywhere. It's a parameter by which we measure the entire universe. However, you could put a clock on a subatomic particle. That's called proper time. And yes, there is a formulation of quantum mechanics where there is a clock on each particle as it moves in space and time. But does it have a physical significance? Well, not that we know of. We think that it's a way to parameterize space and time. Now, Einstein says that space and time are not really different. That if I move at a certain velocity, I can rotate space into time and time into space. And so time no longer has an individual meaning. That is, space can be interchanged with time simply by moving in a straight line. And then he wrote down, of course, his famous equations, which make this possible. At first, people thought, wow, this is nonsense. Time turns into space. Space turns into time. But yeah, not only that, but matter turns into energy. Energy turns into matter. So not just space and time, but matter and energy also turn into each other. And the simplest consequence of that is the atomic bomb. The atomic bomb is a consequence of the fact that time can turn into space, space can turn into time, which forces matter to turn into energy, and energy to turn into matter. So that a rock, like uranium, can be turned into energy in the form of a nuclear fireball through Einstein's equations. Okay, let's move on now to the next listener phone call.
Dr. Kaku, this is Ben Stanton from Dallas, Texas. I'm calling because I saw your Twitter post. I've read The Future of Physics in 2012, and it was very encouraging. My question to you is there any evidence in our reality that the Earth ever had exactly 360-day rotations around the sun? If so, why do we now have 365-day rotations if that is possible? Is it possible for the Earth to have different rotations around the sun than we do now and it still be habitable? Thank you very much for your time and wish you all the luck. God bless.
Well, that's a very interesting question because, first of all, we have Newton's laws of gravity, which allows us to calculate the trajectory of the Earth. But now we have supercomputers. Supercomputers which allow us to hit the fast forward button or the rewind button to go back millions, billions of years into the past. And that opens up a whole new realm of astronomy because we're not used to thinking of the solar system billions of years ago. For example, the moon came out of the Earth about 4 billion years ago, and it was much closer to the Earth. And so a day on the Earth was different than a day back then. Same thing with a year. So we know that a year is 365 days, but that was not always true. And in fact, 4 billion years ago, an object about the size of Mars plowed into the Earth, gouged out a huge chunk of the Earth, which then solidified under gravity, and it became the moon. So we know, therefore, that what we see today was not the way it was, and in the future, it may not be the way it will be in the future.